So I'd like to paint a picture. Many years ago, before I was married, my roommate Marilyn and I lived in one, we rented one of those brownstone homes in Brooklyn, New York, in the Jewish section of town. It was an interesting apartment. You walked in the main front doors, and our apartment was immediately to the left. There were five rooms: the living room, the kitchen, the bathroom off the kitchen, with no sink in it, by the way, and she had her bedroom with no closet, and I had my bedroom with no closet. Now, each room was painted a different shade of green. The rooms were small, and we didn't have very many resources at all, but we made do. Someone was gracious enough to give us a table, and we had a couple of chairs, and we found this couch laying on the street. It had been abandoned. It had a couple of broken legs, and that didn't stop us. We hauled it home, and we put a couple bricks where the legs should have been, and so we had a couch of sorts. Somebody gave us a single bed, and I think Marilyn slept on the floor until we found a bed for her. So it was pretty simple living. So that's the background, the backdrop for this story. Now, my roommate Marilyn was a nurse midwife, and she took the bus to and from the hospital where she worked because I had totaled her car. And there was this other couple in church. Their names were Janice and Bob, and they were also Westerners. They were from here in California. He had just finished his medical school. He was from Guadalajara, and he was doing his free year of service there at the Coney Island Hospital. We also had another Westerner. His name was Gary. He was single, he was a teacher, and he had done his master's degree in marriage and family therapy. So the five of us became family. And we would often spend Friday nights and Sabbaths together breaking bread and having fellowship. Now, we had this we had this kind of unwritten rule that we all just got together and anybody could invite whoever they wanted over for Sabbath lunch. So this one week, Marilyn and I decided to invite the pastor and his wife over for lunch. And Janice was working, so Bob came, and he brought his friend Reuben. He was also a doctor. And Gary came, and I don't remember if he brought anybody, but Marilyn I don't know if she invited somebody or not, but this other lady showed up, and I just assumed that Marilyn had invited her, and Marilyn assumed that I had invited her, but it didn't matter. She was welcome. But there was one little problem. We ran out of food. It all was devoured, and we all hadn't eaten yet. So we scrounged through the cupboards, and we opened another can or two of green beans, and everyone had a little bit. Just two days ago, most of us celebrated Thanksgiving dinner. Some of you had stuffed turkeys, and some of us were stuffed turkeys when we completed our meal. My guess is that none of us came up short. I'm guessing that you at your table had an abundance of food. Today, Raina has set this marvelous table. Thank you, Raina. It's beautiful, isn't it? Do you see any challenges, though? Yeah, no food. Everything is set for a feast, but no food. The table represents our lives. Our lives are filled with an abundance of good things. Wouldn't you agree? Most of us have far more than we need. We have blessings upon blessings. We clean up and dress up pretty well. The table's set, but the food is missing. Now, I'm not talking about physical food. Do you remember how full you felt after Thanksgiving dinner? Hopefully you were satisfied. Some of you probably were stuffed and longed for a nap. Maybe some of you took a walk to walk off some of the calories. What I'm wondering today is, did you come hungry to meet the Creator God of the universe? Did you come here today hungry? Moses, in remembering the 40 years with the congregation of Israel, said in Deuteronomy 8:3, "So he humbled you. He allowed you to hunger and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man shall not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that proceeds from the mouth of the Lord." Have you ever pictured a seed? It's exciting to see when we plant those seeds, the first two leaves appear. But the plant hasn't matured yet. Depending on what it is, it may take months or years, unless, of course, it's like lettuce or radishes, which have a short time for maturity. But sometimes the plant doesn't mature if it doesn't get the amount of water it needs, or the soil's depleted, or it's too rocky, or if it burns from the sun's rays, or it gets trampled, or it gets eaten by the birds, or dug up by the gophers. There's a lot of things that can kill a plant before harvest or maturity. On the other hand, have you noticed that you don't need to take any extra care or effort to grow weeds? They just grow. You don't want them, you didn't plant them. They rarely die on their own. In fact, if given time, they will choke out the plants you intended to grow if you don't carefully cultivate your plant. But before you plant the seeds you want to grow, something has to happen. What? That seed has to die. It had to break down and it had to quit being a seed to nourish the new life growing out of it. Because of Adam's sin, we have all received a sinful nature. Jesus Christ died on the cross to free us from the condemnation of sin. As we accept his death, we too must die to our sinful life. We have to die first to live. Interesting concept. Paul said, "I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who gave himself for me." Being crucified is not a modification of the old life. It's a new birth experience. In Matthew 16:24, Jesus said to his disciples, "If anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up the cross and follow me." That word deny, sometimes we're not too good about that. Crucifixion wasn't merely wearing a cross around the neck. It was the most painful, excruciating experience. It was shameful. It was agonizing. Death on the cross was public humiliation. It was a visual reminder that sin has awful consequences. But it's not enough to just die to self. We live a new life. When a child is born, we don't expect them to feed themselves, right? And walk the next day. Now, I'm telling you, antelope do, but not human race. For humans, it's a slow maturing process. But what happens if a child is not nurtured, loved, or fed? We call that failure to thrive, right? Depending on the circumstances, the child could fail to develop properly if the right nutrients are not provided. In our Christian life, there are characteristics for growing in Christ, and we're going to briefly today look at seven of them. First, we need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Nicodemus was a good man. A Pharisee. However, in his life he felt something was missing. So he came to Jesus for an interview at night. And Jesus cut quick to the heart of the matter. He said in John 3:5, "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born of water, unless one and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." The Holy Spirit convicts us of sin. It instructs us in righteousness. It teaches us. We need the Holy Spirit. Jesus said in John 14:16-17, "I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever." I like that word abide, don't you? That he may abide with you. The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. That is fellowship. So how do we respond to this Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive? Do we obey his still small voice, or do we grieve him by our lack of interest or willingness to listen? The next point, next characteristic for growing in Christ: we love others and we grow in unity. Jesus prayed that we would love each other. He said we even needed to love our enemies. Now that's a pretty tall order. Do good to those who hate us. Naturally, there are people that we have difficulty with, and there are other people that we have affinity to. How do we treat those who have differing opinions? Are we nasty to them, or do we love them and pray for them? Do we pray that we will have Jesus' attitude in mind for them? Does everyone have to see things our way? Or are we open to God's growth? Being in unity is different than being in uniformity. I like to liken it to an orchestra. The trumpet section calls for action. The flutes gracefully dance. And the tubas accent the bass notes. And the drums beat the rhythm for the whole symphony. The trombones slide through life, accenting the counter melodies at times, and the clarinets airily give their plaintive appeals. The violins soar, unrestrained, but they are all part of the grand symphony. They work together, and they leave us breathless and moved. What if we saw each other as essential and gifted, and on the same team, would we treat each other differently? Our next characteristic for growing in Christ, we continue to study God's word. God speaks to us through his word. And if we're not spending time absorbing his word daily, we're missing out on much communication. Jeremiah said, "Your words were found, and I did eat them. It was to me the joy and rejoicing in my heart, for I am called by your name, O Lord God of hosts." Do we eat the bread that Jesus offers us? Do we come to the table for table fellowship with him? Here's a little sidebar. My fur balls often join me for my devotional time in the morning. I think, personally, that they take this text personally. They will lay right down next to the word of God. And sometimes they will even lie on the word of God. And sometimes they will use their little mouths and they will try to eat the pages from God's word. And it reminds me, do I come to the Bible hungry to hear God commune with me? Or, you know, am I in such a hurry sometimes that I just want a quick verse and I'm satisfied with God's fast food? One of my favorite questions I ask when studying is, what is God trying to teach me through this story or this passage? When we see God as speaking to us through his word, it changes our one-on-one time with him. We come eager to hear his voice. Another characteristic is we have a prayer life. I've always liked this statement. 7 days without prayer makes 1 week. I looked to see what the trend is for Christians praying. And I looked at another set of information for the age group of and the percentage of people praying. And it goes down progressively from the silent generation to the millennials and to the Gen Xers. Do we spend time talking to God and eating his word? So much could be said about prayer. Daniel prayed 3 times a day. Even when the king issued an edict, nothing could stop him. Prayer is so personal. And Jesus invited us to a prayer closet, secretly seeking him. He says, "And when you pray, don't be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogue and on the corners of the streets that they may be seen by men. And when you pray, assuredly I say to you that they have their reward, but when you pray, go into your room, and when you've shut your door, pray to your Father, and who is in the secret place. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. You know, prayer is not so much asking God for our needs, although he's glad to hear our desires, but it's for us to open our hearts to where he's working. Prayer is also praise and thanksgiving. I like this statement. Prayer is the key in the hand of faith to unlock heaven's storehouses. What if we got serious about prayer? What if we stormed heaven's throne room, interceding for our families, our friends, our church, our nation, for the world? What if we prayer walked around our neighborhood? What if we prayed for those who are hurting, not just saying, I'm praying for you, but actually praying with them in the moment? I'm growing in this area. I'm friends with the Episcopal pastor down the street, and we try to get together at least once a month. And it's such a joy to pray with her. I'm blessed when we pray together. Elaine Price and I, we walk around Sinaloa Lake twice a week. And on the last lap around Sinaloa Lake, we pray. We prayer walk the whole way. And sometimes when we meet her friend, her neighbor Susan, we'll see her, we'll talk to her, and we'll pray with her. What if we did that more? What if our eyes were opened to more prayer opportunities? The next characteristic is we bear fruit. Galatians 5:22 and 23 tells us, it's a familiar text, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. You know, you don't have to tell an apple tree to grow apples. And you don't have to tell an orange tree to produce oranges. And you don't have to encourage an avocado tree to produce avocados. It happens. It happens if the trees are receiving the nutrients they need, the water, the sunshine, the good soil. And if we in our lives don't have those characteristics, all of them, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, etc., in our lives, maybe something is deficient in the soil of our hearts. Maybe we need to pray and ask God what's missing. God's desire for us is to have joy in trials and tribulations. He desires us to have faith in the rough moments. He desires us to have peace in the shadows and disappointments. So we need to take an inventory. And I don't know about you, but it's easy for me to be self-deceived and to justify my outbursts or excuse my bad behavior. And that leads us to the next point. We are involved in spiritual warfare. Paul writes this text, and it's a long one, but it's a powerful one. He says, put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. It's a real battle. If you aren't feeling the heat, maybe you're a deserter. He continues on, therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all, to stand. Stand, therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the gospel of peace, above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. being watchful to the end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. It's a battle. It's a warfare. And don't you see it as we see the news today and we see the various things going on? Life is not going to get easier. Life is not a picnic. The ants are there. The mosquitoes are out in full force. The storm's coming. In fact, it's here. We are called to put on every piece of armor so that we can be strong, not in our strength, but strong in the Lord. We are involved. The next characteristics, we are involved in worship and witness. The author of Hebrews says in Hebrews 10, 25 and 26, he says, "And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching." What happens when you take a campfire and separate the logs from each other? The logs quit burning. And when we isolate ourselves from fellowship with fellow believers, we're in danger of becoming discouraged, cold, passive. But when we choose to be in fellowship with one another, we grow. We care. We love. We are encouraged. Too much isolation can lead us to be self-centered and disinterested. And we witness, not because we have to or should. We witness because something has happened in our own lives. We've experienced table fellowship with Jesus. And those God moments when God is at work in our lives fill us with joy for his precious blessings, his grace, his forgiveness, his love. A witness of an accident share what they saw, they experienced. A witness for Jesus shares how God is working in the day-to-day events. It's not a forced, contrived experience. It flows out of a life that has been rich with connection with our Lord and Savior. It flows from a life that has experienced the healing from the bondage of sin. So these are the seven characteristics of a growing life in Christ. They show that we've had table fellowship with him. So what are Satan's fake news narratives? You remember the text that we've been using for this series found in Revelation 12:15. So the serpent spewed water out of his mouth like a flood after the woman that he might be cause her to be carried away by the flood. What is it a flood of? It's a flood of lies, right? Satan wants to flood us with a flood of lies. So what are some of the lies that he tells us about growing in Christ? One of them is that we are really good people. Life is good. Life is comfortable. I'm a good person. Revelation 3:17 paints the picture well. It says, "I am rich. I've become wealthy. I have need of nothing. And you do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked." Note who says this. If you look in the verses before it, it's the faithful and true witness, the one who knows us through and through, the one who has no self-deception. But there's good news. He has a remedy. His remedy is stable fellowship. I'm always amazed at people who say, so-and-so is a good person. If anybody's going to be in heaven, they're going to be in heaven. Do you know what's wrong with that picture? God says the heart is wicked. No one is good but God. Friends, we're not saved by our goodness. We're not saved by our goodness. Can I hear an amen? We are not saved by our goodness. That will never get us to heaven. We are saved by knowing and loving the one who is good and accepting his free gift of grace by faith and letting his love transform our hearts that are so prone to wander. Well, on the flip side, if the devil can't make us believe that we are so good, we're just going to be in heaven, he gives us the other side of the coin that says we aren't good enough. Never will be. The bondage of sin cannot be broken in our lives. We can't pull ourselves up by our bootstraps. The bondage of sin can't be broken by trying harder. If Satan can get us in one ditch or the other, he's happy. He will have us grovel in our badness with our hopelessness and helplessness. Yes, we are sinners. Yes, we fall short of the glory of God. But Paul reminds us in Philippians 1:6, this is a promise I love, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. Isn't that good news? God has not abandoned us. He is still working in our lives. And John reminds us in 1 John 5:13, these things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may wonder that you have eternal life, right? Is that what it says? No, he says that you may know that you have eternal life and that you may continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. I like that kind of assurance. So when Satan, the accuser, the brethren, throws our sin in our face, and we've already repented, and we've turned from those sins, we can say, thank you, Jesus, you have forgiven me, you have cleansed me from all unrighteousness. You've clothed me with your pure, spotless robe of the righteousness of Jesus. I know that I'm forgiven. I don't feel like it, but I know your promises are faithful and true, and you've removed my sins and thrown them in the bottom of the sea, and you don't go deep sea fishing. Thank you, Jesus. The other fake news that Satan perpetrates is that Bible study is optional. Table fellowship is optional. We've already heard it before. There are precious truths that God wants to reveal to us daily. His faithfulness is new every morning. He desires to have this living, growing relationship with us. He longs for that table fellowship with us daily. He sets the best table so that we can be satisfied. In fact, more than satisfied, that we can have joy in the abundance of his blessings and communion with us. Another lie that the devil perpetrates is we don't need to pray. We don't need to earnestly pray. God already knows your needs. Prayer doesn't make a difference. Oh, friend, how the devil wants us to neglect the power source for a victorious Christian life. He knows that when we're seeking and praying earnestly for our friends and our neighbors, our community, our church, our nation, that it gives the angels of God permission to work in ways that we have little right realization regarding. But most of all, when we share in the passion of seeking the lost, it changes our focus from self-serving to God-honoring. Another lie of Satan is that worshiping and witnessing are optional. The devil would have us worship anything but God. Worship money, worship possessions, worship status, worship sports. The devil would have us bickering, niggling, gossiping, and critically comparing ourselves with others, whom we classify as less than equal. He would have us be so self-absorbed that we don't see the God moments when God shows up in remarkable ways. So, friend, the table is set. God desires to have table fellowship with you. Have you come hungry? Quickened by his spirit? Have you heard his voice? Eaten his bread? Have your hearts burned within you as he met you individually and us collectively? Or has Satan snatched the morsels that God has abundantly provided and you've come up short? Christ longs for each person on planet Earth to grow in a personal relationship with him. He knows that all of us come up short every time we try to do it on our own. So the question is, will you come to God's table, or will you eat the fruit of the enemy, the forbidden fruit of the enemy, and believe his lies? He invites us to his banqueting table. Let's pray. Father in heaven, you have this rich banqueting table for us every day. And too often, Father, we've been guilty of neglecting it. We haven't taken the time to hear your voice or to eat of your food or to commune with you and talk with you as friend and as Savior and as Lord of our lives. Forgive us. Help us to come hungry, to hear you, and to be transformed by you. And we thank you for your promises, that you who begin this good work in us will complete it. Thank you. Amen.